welcome you to our today's seminar and presentation. Of course, the word Thomas is not in the title of the of today's presentation, but it is on everybody's mind, so I'm sure there will be that word will be mentioned in the presentation. It's my pleasure to introduce Tornike Metreveli, who is known for quite few of you, because Tornike, you were at the Davis Center, was it 2 years ago?
1 year, 1.5 years ago.
One and a half years ago. Okay, so welcome back. Tornike is a student of nationalism with research interests in intersection of nationalism and religion in the geographical spaces of the former Soviet Union and Yugoslavia. Currently, he is an international postdoctoral fellow at the University of St. Gallen. And of course, we have a lot in common when it comes to our research that done here at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute with St. Gallen University, and even share some fellows, including Victoria Sereda, who was at St. Gallen and now she's with us. Tornike received his doctorate in sociology, magna cum laude, from the University of Bern in 2017, where he was a Swiss government's excellent scholarship holder, studying under the supervision of Professor Christian Jobke. Before joining the University of St. Gallen, Tornike was a research fellow at the Davis Center, as it was already mentioned, at London School of Economics and House of Commons, UK Parliament. It will be interesting at some point to hear what your research and your stay there involved. But again, your current project is at the University of St. Gallen, brings original insight into the organizational ecology of Orthodox churches, their operational tactics and geopolitical assertions in Ukraine, and this is exactly the focus of your today's presentation. So welcome, and we're looking forward to really very interesting presentation.
Thanks everyone, and I'm very thankful for having such a wonderful introduction. I'm very grateful to be back to where it actually all started, because this idea of this project was born in Davis Center in Curie, and I'm in conversations with Professor Plochy and other fellows at Davis Center. So I'm going to be going briefly through the problem that brought me to the topic, and then I'll try to bring the fieldwork results that I have, and then we can have a discussion, hopefully, that will be interesting to you. So the first big question that was initially, that was puzzling, why is sociology of religion overwhelmingly, the literature of sociology on religion overwhelmingly, ignores or doesn't pay enough attention, enough scholarly attention to the Orthodox Christianity? Well, there were branches of different social thought. Some of the major thinkers, such as Jose Casanova, pointed out that there should be some kind of conceptual apparatus that will help us to understand this non-Western, non-secular modernities, right? Very often, on the other, the critique was mentioned about the religious role. So religion is often either over or underestimated, and that was part of the puzzle, so why there is no kind of golden middle to understand what's going on in parts of the world that are dominated culturally by the Orthodox Christianity. And the third question was, of course, why the Russian model was kind of a modus operandi for all other Orthodox countries. Obviously, there are a number of contextual nuances and historical details which are fascinating, and to taking Russian model of church-state relationships and then applying and generalizing that to the rest of the Orthodox countries is reductionist and is, of course, was conceptually misleading. So there are a few wonderful books written on the subject of interaction of church and state. First and foremost was Anna Grzymalabius's book Nations Under God by Princeton University Press, that look at how churches actually influence public policy using their moral authority to influence policies, and how they're operating in the kind of closed door meetings and in the liberal democracies. However, overwhelming focus was on Catholic churches. Second book, a very recent one by Kirill Hovorun, is about political orthodoxy. That brings us a very nuanced details on the theological angle of things. So it shows us how churches use theological in some form theological concepts for their political activities. And the third book was by John Burgess about Holy Russia, so it kind of shows us the grassroots operational tactics of the Orthodox churches. But then the question was, of course, so what's so distinctive about Ukraine that gives us a scholarly interest to kind of engage into this debate? There are many reasons why Ukraine, beyond just personal reasons, that I find it fascinating country and a great of great culture. There is a lot to be said about the robust national identity that Ukraine has. And I think the religious angle of this discussion gives us compelling evidence for that. Another thing is that the religious field, in a very Buddhism kind of concept of field, that is very diverse. And Ukraine is one of the most religiously plural countries in Europe. It has one of the most liberal legislature in Europe when it comes to freedom of conscience. So it's an incredibly different from almost all other Orthodox countries of the former Soviet Union. And of course, as I briefly said, there were huge problems, theoretical problems, that were noted by many scholars like Lustian, Rudometov, and others, who said there is a call for, in social theory, to understand and accurately frame and explain the political operations of the churches and their influence on public policies and their geopolitical implications. And the fourth reason was of my focus on why Ukraine. I think that this case particularly shows that how Orthodox Christian church-state relations in Orthodox countries relate to IR theories, international relations theories, and in particularly geopolitics. So with this kind of with this sort of theoretical standing, I went to the field in Ukraine after consulting in the beginning, in a very early stage of my research, with Sergei Plohy about the trajectory of research. So I ended up in a very interesting part of Ukraine. I actually started from Western Ukraine, and then all the way, I'll show you the trajectory of the research, so all the way to the central and parts of central east of Ukraine. So what was compelling was kind of a very, very banal working hypothesis that I somehow developed. This is neither negated nor confirmed in this, but it just like was a working thesis that I encountered. So basically, when religion engaged somehow in nationalism, the political domain became somewhat religious domain. Whether it was in a public sphere, as we can see in this, it's already gone, but in 2nd of April, that was near Maidan, a massive banner in central Kiev saying that freedom is our religion, quote from President Poroshenko. Whether in a public sphere, and we see here the president with the head of the Kiev Patriarchate, Filaret, on the commemorating the day of baptism of Kievan Rus on 28th of July, or whether it's in the political rhetoric. And there are a number of statements, and I will try to be as short as I can, but there are some of the most important which I brought to your attention. This is President Poroshenko saying, a body cannot be free when the soul is in captivity. So for the nation state that he envisions, it is very central for national security of Ukraine to have this freedom, spiritual freedom. And we have a firm intention to cut off the last tie with which the empire desperately tries to bind us. And he's talking about Russia, obviously. And here we go with the magic word, Thomas. The issue of Thomas of autocephaly for the Orthodox Church of Ukraine goes far beyond the religious beyond the religious issues. And then he links it to the NATO integration agenda and the European Union. And actually he says that it's a strategic benchmark for Ukraine. So this is just the rhetoric, right? And of course, this interaction of religious analogous interaction with religion and nationalism was visible in the church. This was the picture actually on the poster that is distributed, that was distributed on the campus. So this is an icon of Christ with Ukrainian national symbols, as you can see, and artillery bombardment pieces and a few bullets on the display in Lviv. This is a Greco-Catholic church in Lviv. You see a beautiful Vyshivanka. This was taken in Dnieper, and Jesus with a bullet in a part of his head. And so this was brought from the front line, and this entire church in Dnieper, is full of the kind of war memories in a way, and there are a lot of commemorations of the victims of war. Or, of course, this interaction between religion and nationalism is very visible in a private setup. This is the home of one of my informants. This is a scarf, flag, and a Patriot Filarets picture. So basically, somehow this was the trajectory that again, drove me into this bigger questions. But then we have to understand the context, right? The context, and this is just how many? I think 10, 15, 12 religious organizations that operate, and there are 12,000 more. So Ukraine, as I told you, is an incredibly diverse field. So the major players in my focus of my research were the Orthodox churches. And at the time when I actually was in field, this was the all these discussions about autocephaly and Thomas were at its best. I've had four visits in Ukraine. So I will focus on the newly formed Orthodox Church of Ukraine, Russian Orthodox Church in Ukraine, as it now renamed before it was Ukrainian Orthodox Church of Moscow Patriarchate, and the Kiev Patriarchate that kind of merged with the newly formed church. Yeah, and it goes on and on. So there are a few data from Razumkov Center about the affiliation and the kind of geographical distribution. We see that in the western part of Ukraine, out of the people who identify themselves with being Orthodox, 64% identified with the Kiev Patriarchate, and this is before the Thomas. Central Ukraine is 48.2%, whereas the south is around 36, and east is around 24. Very interesting is this just Orthodox category, which is kind of on steady rise in pretty much everywhere. So how this new Orthodox Church of Ukraine was formed, right? This was the three main Orthodox churches of Ukraine merged into this one newly formed church that got its autocephaly, Thomas of Autocephaly, from the Patriarch of Constantinople in January this year. So this is autocephalous church, this is Kievan Patriarchate, and a few bishops from the Russian Orthodox Church, from the Moscow Patriarchate, right? So the big question, of course, then was, why now, given that autocephaly has been requested a few times by other leaders, and what was so compelling that it actually manifested in final acceptance of this autocephaly now? There have been requests and different sort of trajectories of this revival of church. Again, there were splits from the Kiev Patriarchate, between the Kiev Patriarchate and the Russian Orthodox Church, led by currently Patriarch Filaret. There were requests for autocephaly that failed, there was the Orange Revolution, second kind of round of requests. There was Euromaidan, which was arguably a game changer, and I will speak why. There happened annexation of Crimea. These are events that church directly took, in overwhelming majority of them, took direct part. And
what is Thomas?
Thomas is an autocephaly. Autocephaly is independence of church, basically, having a right to elect its own patriarch. That's what Ukraine received in the beginning of January. Of course, very important was the political context. Why did it happen now? The annexation of Crimea or in eastern Ukraine and the revolution were the three major events where church was actively responding to, right? In regards to, and it was kind of the divisive point between the churches in a way. Euromaidan saw Kievan church involved in more civic projects where different church opened the door for the victims of Maidan, and for the heroes of Maidan, and also there was a different response in the war, how the churches actually responded to the war. So again, there was an address of the president and the parliament. So there was a domestic consensus and there was a public support, which basically was quite supportive of the autocephaly. So these three elements, I'm not, of course, we cannot verify whether these three factors were very key for the Patriarch of Constantinople to make the decision, but this were the context that led to the discussion. There were requests, many argued in some of the forums which I was really very much actively following, that there was no request sent to the Russian Church. So why to ask the Patriarch of Constantinople in the first place? Well, of course, the major issue is, why does it matter what the Patriarch of Constantinople say in the first place? I mean, it is a historical debate, and Russian Orthodox Church and the Patriarch of Constantinople disagree on who is the Mother Church and who has the right to give this Thomas of autocephaly. However, both autocephalous church as well as the Kievan Patriarchate have asked the Russian Orthodox Church a few times throughout the last two decades, and the response was rejected. Request for Thomas. So the question then is, what's so geopolitical about what seems to be a very very religious matter, right? Very religious question. Why geopolitics is the discussion that we are engaged in? Well, one very clear answer is that because Kremlin cares about that, and it actually cares a lot, and we can see in this book project have done a media analysis, also the discourse analysis, which does a lot of different kind of media work to promote this idea that this is the end of the Orthodox Christianity, because this uncanonical church is getting the Thomas. This will change the rule of the game for every other church. There have been fears that Ukraine will end up in a civil war, religiously driven civil war, and of course the main topic, in two occasions, one occasion particularly in the last 4 months of the Russia's Federal Security Council meeting, was Ukrainian autocephaly. This was attended by Putin, Medvedev, head of FSB, counterintelligence, minister of internal affairs, and minister of defense, and the conversation was about the autocephaly of Ukraine. So this is a transcript of the conversation between the Patriarch Kirill and Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew when Patriarch Kirill visited Fanar in Istanbul. So basically the kind of head office of the Ecumenical Patriarchate. And I will go into the details of that. So Ecumenical Patriarch basically says that Ukrainians don't feel comfortable under the control of Russia. There is a public support for the independence, for Thomas, and they came to the Mother Church, and so not only just the president, but prime minister and parliament. So there is a kind of a broader public consensus, and basically there is the full legitimacy of this request, and it's inevitable that we will recognize that. To what Patriarch Kirill answers that we have never abandoned the notion that we are one country and one people. It is impossible for us to separate Kiev from our country. And this is where our history began. The Russian Orthodox Church preserves the national consciousness of both Russians and Ukrainians. So if there is still a question why geopolitics is important, we will look at the concept of Russkii Mir. And here I would be dividing that in this kind of three pillars. Russkii Mir, it is a Russian world as an idea, as an ideology, and as a project, right? So this whole conversation started obviously this has been in intellectual discussion in Russia for many years, but in this particular religious framework in 2009, where Patriarch Kirill attended this forum of the Russian World Organization, where he says kind of monumental phrase, basically the basis of Russian world today is Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus, and this is all Rus, despite being divided by state borders and incompatibilities with certain policies, we continue to remain spiritually one nation. So this notion of us being one nation was very, very important in the discourse. And of course, we must admit, says Patriarch, that these borders, at least for today, and this is 2009, with the present character of all these border situations, create uncertainty, certain obstacles between the peoples of Russian world. And then there is a question of belonging. So who belongs to this idea? Who is part of this Russian world, right? And the cornerstone of Russian world, Patriarch says, is culture and language. However, he is not very much ethno-specific. There is no ethnic particularity, a particularism involved. He says Georgians, Russians, Tatars, Ukrainians can belong to Russian culture, because it absorbed the traditions of many people, of these people. So Russian culture is a phenomenon that does not fit within the borders of one state. If we actually zoom it out, or maybe we kind of divide it in subsections, this whole speech, we can say that if we look at Russkii Mir as an idea, it is beyond borders, where the physical kind of territorial borders are relative, and it is about kind of common historical memory. And this the meaning of this historical memory is, of course, interpreted through the Russian lenses. Russkii Mir as a project is a predisposition to believe into this in an alternative reality, in a way. This reality which is factually relative, right? Factually relative, and I'll elaborate what exactly I mean when I will go to the fieldwork section. Or national boundaries of sovereign territory of the nation state are diminished by historical and cultural relativism, right? Russkii Mir as an ideology, and here we are kind of at the intersection of a cultural strand of social theories, is a kind of profound and fundamental rejection of the Western values. And in this case, we're talking about different elements of, for example, social and moral vulnerabilities that Western societies have, and this portraying the Orthodox civilization as something of a superior value system, right? But this discussion was accompanied by the competing discourse in Ukraine, which was a discourse of the so-called Pomesnaya Tserkov, Unified State, United Church. And I will give you a few quotes before going to the field part. The Ukrainian church for the Moscow Patriarchate has a great not only religious significance but also political significance, because if there were no Kiev Patriarchate today, Putin would have reigned in Ukraine. This is a quote by Patriarch Filaret, and Patriarch Filaret was behind the split, as I briefly mentioned, of the Kiev Patriarchate that was not canonical until very recent. So he was behind this split from the Russian Orthodox Church. Here again we see this consensus between the political discourse, political rhetoric, and a religious one. And here we go back to the Poroshenko's statement: a body cannot be free when a soul is in captivity, right? So we're determined to put an end, as he said. So the major issue for the state is to kind of create this idea of nation state, where religion is a pillar. It is an instrument of civic nationalism. It is an instrument, according to the logic, it is an instrument that can unite, notwithstanding the language preferences. It is a kind of a civil religion that is a mechanism of creating the political consensus. The big question is, where are the people? So in this clash of the two discourses, on the one hand, we have this idea, project, and ideology of Russkii Mir, with its own kind of geostrategic visions of what Ukraine is and should be. On the other side, we have this discourse of autocephalous church and independence, and linking that very closely to the statehood and existence, national security questions for Ukraine. So with that sort of information from historical sources and policy analysis, I went to the field. Of course, my positioning as a researcher was I was not an insider. I'm not from Ukraine, so it was interesting to see that from step back and look at myself as an outsider to the culture, but very close to the values. So I tried to use a very particular sampling strategy. I'm not going to bore you with a lot of sociological stuff that is not very relevant, but I should say that because my colleagues will be watching this probably, and I have to save my sociology reputation anyway. So my sampling strategy was a purposive sampling. So basically I studied particular group that was the communities that changed from one church to another. In this case, I looked at the parishes of the Moscow Patriarchate who went to the Kiev Patriarchate. At the time of my fieldwork, there were 72 communities. Now there are 452. So there was a significant change after the autocephaly was received within the month, and I would go to the MAPA project, who tracks that very nicely, how the within the last 2 months where exactly these parishes have moved. So my data gathering in numbers were 22 settlements in 8 regions and 77 interviews. And I'm going back to Ukraine with the same questions, but to reflect once more on my findings. So I'm going in summer again to the same trajectory. And this was the trajectory of my research. This map was kindly provided by Risu. So I basically followed the map because these were the parishes that were either in the situation of religious disagreements, legal arguments with each other, or were actually in red spots. They were already completed the transition from one authority of one church to another. And for your note, this was January 22nd. Already we see these are parishes that have moved to the Kiev Patriarchate. This is January, and this is the MAPA data that shows that, predominantly, as you can see, there are a lot of parishes already, as I told you, more than 400. Majority of them were in the western and central Ukraine. However, we also see that in the northern and the east, central northern Ukraine, there'll be a few more parishes. Within the 1 month, this acceleration happened within 1 month. After 6th of January until the end of January, there were already 145 communities. And when we're talking about communities, we don't mean just a few parishioners. We're talking sometimes about an entire village, which was in one church. And the big question, of course, is what happens to the immovable property and how the property will be divided, who owes the right to particular property, whether they're icons and whether they are the church buildings. And there were a lot of ongoing court hearings as we speak in Ukraine with regards to this particular issue. So then Ukrainian government adopted the new law that allows very much of a decentralization, how this skirmishes will be fixed, if there are. So it is very village to village basis. There is no central government involvement that much. So individual parishes have particular voting systems, how they vote, whether they want to join the new church or not. So sometimes they need 50% plus one majority. Sometimes it's about two-thirds. But the mechanisms are based on so-called ustawy, which are regulatory documents of the churches. The question then, of course, was what does this big discursive constructs mean to the ordinary people, right? What does Russkii Mir mean? How is it practiced in daily life? And I have to give you a short reflection on a story that I've heard in the field. Basically, this is a very long quote, which I basically reduced to just a few things. So the person that was talking to me about this was a driver, a former priest that brought the disabled children to the Pochayev Lavra, which is in the western part of Ukraine. And he was a parishioner of the Moscow Patriarchate. However, the one of the disabled kids was a parishioner of Moscow Patriarchate. However, the others, the sister of that child was a parishioner of the Patriarch of Constantinople. So he brings these two kids to the priest, and the priest asks whether he wants to pray for someone. And then he gives these names, and then he says, can you please write in Ukrainian the whole text, what you want to do? And then he says, he can correct that and gives back, so the Tatiana should be mentioned, Tatiana should be corrected to Tatiana, and it's not Dimitro, and it should be Dimitri. And then they started the conversation about, so why exactly it should be. And this very banal, basic conversation went to the really high geopolitical conversation on the meaning of Russkii Mir and how it is practiced. And then this is another interesting quote, which I got from the from one male in Ternopil. So it's he says this whole idea is like McDonald's. It operates like McDonald's. McDonald's operates in more than 100 countries, but the taste of Big Mac is pretty much the same. So it is this the idea of Russkii Mir, he says, it manifested in different forms, but the content is pretty much the same everywhere, right? And the prevalent discourse was among those who changed to the Moscow Patriarchate, this kind of dialectical relationship to the others, in this case the Moscow Patriarchate. So they prayed in Russian, they prayed for the for Kirill, they disregarded our Heavenly Hundred, so no wonder why we change, right? This is the female in Kharkiv. Or for example, the more younger corpses are in the village, they started to arrive from the war, the more people realized how the Moscow Patriarchate actually serves the interest of the occupant state. And in this case, the conversation is of course about the Russia. So there is again, this echoes very much the discourse of the political elites. Or another interview in Dnieper, you cannot commit to dying for Ukraine and pray for Moscow at the same time. It becomes an either or question for me. This either or question is what puzzled me conceptually, and I will speak briefly later and maybe in conversation. What does it exactly mean when people are stuck in between of those kind of identities? I argue that it has a particular conceptual value, so I try to conceptualize that term, which perhaps explains the phenomenon, the nature of phenomenon. But I'll be open to questions on that. Another issue was that this is the conversation with a woman of Armenian descent that was brought up in an Ossetian family and lives in Ukraine. And she says, I think in Russian, I love in Russian, I feel God in Russian. So when in this conversation, when we tried to zoom in into these meanings of thinking in Russian and feeling love of God in Russian, we ended up talking about the canonical, non-canonical conversations. So there is blagodats on one side, which is grace, and there is none of it on the other. So one of the reasons why people switched or didn't switch was the response of individual priests to the tragedies of war. Very often the political discussion was more on structural level. However, on a micro level, the people really care how particular priest responded to the victim of war, or whether he mentioned Patriarch Kirill during the prayer, or whether they prayed in Ukrainian language, or whether they used Old Slavonic in the singing. So these were the factors that in many of these interviews people said were very important for the decision to switch or not to switch. And I'm going to the I think most fascinating for the case of anonymity. I just didn't disclose her visual part, but I think she was a fascinating babusa who was from Western Ukraine, and we had a 3.5 hour conversation. And this is the quote that brought me to this conversation about what I would call identitarian in betweenness as a distinct category of practice. She says, "Why shall I be either in here or here?" Since she talks about Moscow and Kiev Patriarchate, I used to go to the church which was closer to me, to my house, because sometimes I have swollen legs and there's problem of movement, and suddenly we're now the Orthodox, we are now Ukrainians, and I have to ignore an eye contact with my neighbor if I go to one way and the angry my relative goes to another. So I didn't want to stay without church, but this is too much to be patriotic enough, believing enough. I decided not to go to church at all. So let them fight with each other over these issues, and I will remain as a declarative believer. And this is a fascinating concept as well, I think. The declarative believer, which means basically a believer on the paper. So I would be not a churchgoer, but I would be figuratively believing in, figuratively considered to be a part of the church. This leads us to a few points, which again, this is the project in the making, so I have a lot of questions still unanswered. These are the fieldwork materials that have been analyzed and coded, a number of texts. But there are the questions which get me to this identitarian in-betweenness concept, or maybe a thesis or hypothesis, because it is yet to have been tested whether or not it can be verified, right? So this identitarian in-betweenness is characterized, what I argue, occurs in response to civic nationalism of the state, civic nationalism of the political elites, and where people sometimes intentionally or not intentionally are forced to choose one identity over the other. Of course, there in the nationalist studies literature, there are a number of books that deal with multiple identities. However, this identitarian betweenness is not multiple identities. It is about being forced to choose one over the other because of the matter of prestige. At some point, one identity is more prestigious than the other. And this is characterized by undecidedness in motive narratives. And I categorize this as motive narratives, the rational behind making the choice to go to one church or the other. So I characterize that by undecidedness in these motive narratives and very much very frequent fluctuations. And these fluctuations in interconfessional behavior, whether to switch or not to switch. So, and the last one was the response of the Ukrainian state to attempt of creating the secular identity of Ukrainian state is in the making. So it's very volatile and very, very fluid. So a Ukrainian state's response to creation of the secular identity, which finds itself on the civic nationalism, is not a finished end product. And this leaves a huge chunk of people undecided, and they, what this Babusia argued, are declarative believers. And this is a sort of a lived experience of a religion, right? That gets us to this locality of geopolitics, that very much nuances of these localities matter decisively in understanding where we are. I think I will stop here, and I'll have questions.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and thanks a lot for using MAPA. While you're thinking about your first question, I have mine ready. Maybe even two, but they're quite sure. The first one is, what is the role of the priest overall? So you went out there, you interviewed the parishioners. Whether in the cases that you looked at, how many of these cases are driven by the decision of the priest, and in how many cases it's the community that decides, and then if priest and community are on the different sides of divide, again, how many cases would be like that? So that's allegedly the first very short question. And the second is about you pointed to MAPA map, but also to others' map, and mentioned that, okay, there are these regional differences in Ukraine. Whether in your research you noticed that there was regional differences in the way how people formulate their reason to switch, whether the language is equally important in every part of Ukraine, whether the question of grace and blagodat is equally important or not. So again, whether you noticed any regional differences in the way how people formulate their decision.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Fantastic questions. I will. Shall I respond to that or collect the questions?
Maybe we'll respond. Okay. We will just go one by one.
The role of priest. The role of priest differed a lot region by region. And even what's fascinating about Ukraine, unlike, for example, Georgia or Serbia, that was my previous experience of working on Orthodox Christian cases, it's very decentralized, and it's literally goes to the village and individual community. So in some communities, for example, of the Kiev Patriarchate in central and central eastern Ukraine, many priests don't speak Russian language at all. So they're in the parts where the language is the problem to communicate with some of their parishioners, but some priests don't speak Russian well enough. This was my problem because I don't speak well enough Ukrainian. So we had an issue of getting to each other's kind of thick descriptions. There is no central authority like in other Orthodox cases, for example, in Serbian or Russian or Georgian. When bishop or patriarch says something, this goes down, and then this is the policy of the institution. There was a very, very democratic way of dealing with this. Again, I'm not having a representative sample, so in case there is a sociologist in the audience, I know what your next question is. So my sample was not representative, so I cannot claim generalizability. I'm talking about the communities of 77, out of which, of the 77 interviews, around 30 communities. So the role of priest largely depended on what responses he gave to the tragedies. If this particular village had, for example, a few young boys' corpses coming from the war, whether he responded or with prayer or not. For example, the Bilozidia, the village of Bilozidia, near Cherkasy region, had this issue that the priest of the Moscow Patriarchate responded that he prayed for the victims of war, and he prayed, started adapt to this to Ukrainian language. So he prayed in Ukrainian language, and then the conflict was pretty much over. So very often the priests switch the strategies. Sometimes, in for example, in Ternopil and Kremenets, there were cases when they adopted. So they started to not mention the Patriarch Kirill, although this was the actual request from the Moscow Patriarchate at the time, to mention Kirill in every church service. So they were mentioning the patriarchs of all Orthodox churches without specifying the name Kirill, which was annoying for many people in these places. Another issue was that the chaplaincy, not all churches had equal access to chaplaincy. For Kiev Patriarchate has significantly more access as opposed to the Moscow Patriarchate to the chaplaincy in the front of Eastern Ukraine as well as elsewhere. So this was one of the reasons where sometimes the role of priest was different from church to church. Another question was how they formulated reasons to switch, right? Yeah, as I told you, the language, even on the higher level, for example, on the levels of bishops of the Kiev Patriarchate, I'm not sure if that was a policy, deliberate policy of the Kiev Patriarchate, but the language in the clergy, in the highest echelons of clergy, was sometimes a problem because they didn't know advanced Russian. For example, in Kharkiv or in Dnieper, in many of these interviews, there was the problem with there were Western Ukrainian priests that were moved, some of them very recently, to the along the lines of these discussions about Thomas, some of them were moved to the eastern part, central parts of Ukraine, and they were really new in the job, and they were like, okay, so this is something what we're doing now. So yes, the language was, I would say, responses to war were very, very important, and access to the military situation, the people who had access to what's going on in the front, the one that then they returned back, they had a very different standing. And organizational logic of this interconfessional changes, as I told, was basically village to village basis. Sometimes this ustavis, this regulatory documents, allow 50%, like you just need 50% plus one to change. Sometimes it's 2/3, and this procedure varies. So the role of priest is very minimal. It is the parish and the membership of this community that defines who will vote on the final decisive meeting. They have this meeting that decides whether to stay or not in the community.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to follow your lead and also ask two questions. Thank you very much. Fascinating talk. I want to first follow up on what you were saying about the position of the priest, because I've been following this quite closely and I watched like a gazillion YouTube videos, and I actually kind of come in with a little bit different impression. And your concept about this in-between identity, I think it almost applies now to not insignificant number of the actual parishes, because there are conflicting claims as to where this parish actually now belongs. Mm-hmm. Because this process of switching has been very contested. Like you're saying, you know, that there is an ustav and it should be pretty straightforward. I thought that too, until you start watching these meetings and you see actually people very strongly disagreeing, and what are the rules for actually switching. Some of the Russian Moscow Church priests who don't want to switch, they say unless they chair the meeting, it's like not valid, right? Mm-hmm. The law actually says that any kind of group of parishioners can organize a meeting. But then there is a debate as to who actually counts as a parishioner. Like, are you a parishioner if you only go like to two big holidays a year, right? So it actually seems like it seemed like at first when it was announced and the way politically talked about it, it should have been pretty straightforward process, as in like majority met, you know, they voted, you know, end of story. And you mentioned like additionally complication with the ownership, which is the whole other, you know, kettle of fish. But I was sort of wondering, like, is this, like, would you say that it's maybe not as, like, is this additional another way, layer of complication to the switching in addition to obstacles that you were mentioning, that this kind of juridical situation from the point of view of who counts as a parish, who is a member, who can chair, right? And then, so I mean, I'm coming with the impression that it's actually, and even with the MAPA, you click on some of these parishes and you see conflicting reports. Like one report would say that it's now switched, but then like the Moscow Church would dispute it and it's not in significant numbers. So that's like one thing I want to ask you to comment more on the actual process and the obstacles. And my other question is different, but also relates to your project. Could you say a little bit more about the influence that Moscow, like Russia, actually has on the church, on the Moscow Patriarchate Church? Like more specific things, right? I mean, you mentioned, obviously, it's very important for the Russian leadership, you know, from the National Security Council meeting and so forth. And of course, you know, in Ukraine, many believe that it's essentially sort of a tool of Moscow influence, right? But what are some of the concrete, be they like financial, administrative, some sort of concrete levers through which Moscow influences the Moscow Patriarchy Church in Ukraine?
Sure, thank you. Excellent questions, of course. And this problem is eternal. Who counts as membership? Because there is no centralized rule of agreement. And in this sample of my interviews as well, some villagers from the same village, for example, in Kremenets, in the villages near Kremenets, the people had about the same situation, totally different answers. So this decentralization is maybe a problem of fixing. There is no particular way of doing it from the people's perspective who are actually involved in this process. So yeah, I have no idea how to actually solve that, if that's the that's the bottom line. But who can be a member of the parish? It's also it's not again very Ukrainian problem. It's a universal problem for all Orthodox churches, because unlike Catholic churches, the organizational system is peculiar in a sense that there is no way of tracking who is there are no deductions, for example, like in Germany, from your salary to the church that you want to be paying to, and etc. So it is a very complicated situation, and I completely agree with you that it will be perhaps a major, depending on the outcome of elections, it will perhaps be a major issue of further instability on how would that what kind of implications would that have on political change? Influence of Russia on the Russian Orthodox Church was the question. This influence have been it is again very difficult to measure exactly and quantify the influence in numbers. But in Ukraine's case, there is a billionaire who is directly involved in this funding projects. He accompanies the bishops everywhere. He's building the churches, and he's campaigning actively and hiring the lobbyists for the, and particularly against the Thomas discussion. And then there are many journalists in Ukraine who tracked that. And of course, another issue is the involvement, as I said, of the security apparatus. Pet Patrushev coming talking about that what a hugely important thing that is for the Russian state. Sergei Lavrov commenting on the village of Ptsicha. Apparently, that it's a major issue again for the whole Orthodox Church of Russia. So, how much they care is visible and measurable. Whether there is a direct funding mechanisms, it is very difficult to track. I don't have this data to say precisely. Yet again, we have legal initiatives about blasphemy, about religious education in Russia that show us that there is some sort of symphonia between the church and state.
Natalia, please.
Thank you for the talk. I have two kind of more like political practical questions. One is, when exactly did Poroshenko make the request to separate the Ukrainian church? That's first question. The second question, how do you explain this liberalism of the Ukrainian state towards religion?
Thanks. I think the request was somewhere in spring, the first official request when Poroshenko of 2018.
18.
Yes. Either it was mid April, or it was early May. I'm not sure about the date when, but it was in spring of 2018 when there was a formal request on behalf of Poroshenko to address the parliament. That needed also to have some kind of legal consensus to send this request, because you needed the confirmation of parliament, of the president, and that was a procedure to address the Patriarch of Constantinople.
Okay.
regards to the second question, I mean, the law that regulates religion, if we're talking about liberalism of the Ukrainian state, is a unique thing. And it was written, I think, in early 90s, and this allows freedom of religion unseen in other Orthodox countries.
How
do I explain it?
Yes, why is the Ukrainian state so liberal?
By default.
I have actually no idea about that. I mean, there was the law that was done in, I think, 1992, and I would probably refer ask the historians to in the room, maybe that probably the historical context.
No, I responded. It's very simple. By default.
It's
by default. State is too weak. It has been weak all the time, and couldn't enforce any coherent and consistent policy. So they had to accept and to adjust different policies for different regions and to manipulate that's simple.
Yeah, I'll build a little bit on that in the sense that on regional differences and Ukraine historically was an area where there were more church organizations per capita than probably anywhere else in the Soviet Union. 60% of all Russian Orthodox parishes were in Ukraine, and on the top of that, there would be the majority of the Pentecostals and Protestants and so on and so forth there would be in Ukraine. The reason is part of that related to the 1939 annexation of Western Ukraine. Part of that is related to the Germans opening the churches and the Soviets actually not closing all of them. So it was much more pluralistic place than any other. And then the state coming in, of course, was tried to use the Russian model and have a state church for a number of times. It just backfired twice, once under Kravchuk, another time under Kuchma. So they had to accept the pluralism that was that was on the ground. So it's a very, very kind of a short, compressed description of that. Okay, I'm having the list. So if you raise your hand and I'm not reacting right away, please don't be offended. Yes, over there. Yes.
Thank you. I have two questions and one comment. First question is about statistics. I'm wondering is there any statistics of religiosity of the people in Ukraine? What I mean, who considers him herself religious? If there is any statistics by regions, entire Ukraine, or at least about Christians in Ukraine. The second question is again about statistics, but about your respondents. You interviewed, how many people you did you interview, and did you ask them what does it mean for them to be religious, and what is again the level of this religiosity, and did you ask them what it means for them to belong to certain community? And my comment is going along with Professor Burhi's question. It's about motives, why people switch their parish. I think maybe it would enrich your research if you would consider different motivations, which are clearly seen from your quotations, like religious, like political, like personal motives that somebody died during military operations, like cultural motivation, like, I mean, language or some sort of thing. So if you didn't do it before.
Yeah. Oh my God, this is... Oh, okay. So yeah, that was my village in Georgia where I was going every month. So sampling strategy, briefly reflecting the statistics. Yes, there is an excellent statistics, and Razumkov Center has a recent survey, and you can check that on religiosity in Ukraine. So it did a lot of numbers, and also RISU does a great job on that. I had 77 interviews, as I mentioned. And indeed, I asked about the meaning of religiosity and belonging to the community. And as I said, there are varieties of reasons. And now I would not be I wouldn't be speculative about particularly going into the one direction of answer. Of course, it's very difficult to know exactly what is the real reason why people switch, but there are like varieties of reasons, as I mentioned, responses to the war, prayer, mentioning of one particular cleric, for example, Patriarch Kirill or not. There were old cleavages between that were always there, and now it's the time to use. There were organizational interests of the churches, some churches that had interest in particular movable property before, and now that was the moment that was political discourse that actually helped these claims to be legitimate. So yeah, there were a variety of reasons. And that's also partly fascinating about this research project, that it tells not just the policy story and ethnographic story, but very much a day-to-day story of how organization of church operates, how they switch the strategies. For example, at some point, they decided to change the language issue. So they start, in some parts of Ukraine, praying particular language. For example, in Ukrainian language, well, before it was Russian language. At some point, they stopped praying for Kirill during the prayer. So what motivates the individual priests of doing that? That I don't have a qualified response, because I don't have enough evidence to back up my claim with my 77 interviews. And I cannot also generalize about the pattern of changing from one to another, because I have very purposive sampling. I will go back to Ukraine to make this more and work with these communities that have changed and those that are in the court regards to the particular property. So I hope I will have more interesting results with that. Regards to the belonging, as I told you, I categorized these narratives into the illustrative, deviant, and problematic cases, these motive narratives. Very typical narrative of switching was that this church is praying to the aggressor state, and I feel morally wrong to be part of this. This was a typical narrative. But the question, again, what Oksana asked, to what extent these are static categories of practice, right? At some point, they will change. They are now in the making of this new motive narratives of why to change. And there were a lot of this deviant, what I call deviant cases, where this, for example, was an issue of particular behavior of the church, of the clergyman, with regards to mentioning giving service to the child who died and who was baptized in a different church. So there are very individual cases, and in my interviews, people mostly spoke about those three categories, which I say. And please, consult Razumkov Center with regards to the religiosity, because they have a lot of materials in that.
Okay, thank you. Victoria.
Three questions. One, would you say that this split, especially at this phase, which you targeted in your first round of fieldwork, was more urban-rural issue? Because probably in a city, people would have much wider variety of churches to attend, less possibilities to quarrel about. My second question would be about the, you said that Ukrainian identity in Ukraine is pretty rigid, but we had a presentation here at Puri approximately 1.5 years ago, presenting religious identities, and very interesting issue which was demonstrated to us that within one survey, within one and a half hour questioning session, 15% of respondents changed their confessional belonging.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are trying to generalize to the whole country. And the third question would be, we do have, if you look at statistics, we see that there are certain regions that where only 1/3 of the respondents define themselves within certain confession or religion, and 2/3 say either Orthodox or just believers. And then the question would be, what is your take about those regions, and what's your prediction about the situation?
Thank you. The first question is, I completely agree with you that it is a very urban thing, that in urban areas people have much more options to go to which church they want. In central cities it's easier, and the market is much more diverse. In villages, in small villages, there are limited options. sometimes there are a few churches, but overwhelmingly there is one church that has been there always, and now suddenly it is a different church. It belongs to different canonical setup, so it kind of complicates it. So that is, at this point, this is an urban thing. But yet again, we have to closely look at the political context. We don't know what will be the outcome of elections, and now the popular discourse of the ruling elites was autocephaly. President himself advocated for that, and he invested heavily his political and arguably financial capital in this whole campaign, and he made the religion as one of the major issues for his campaign. So, yeah, regards to the third question, whether this one third that you referred to, just believers, I argue these are these ones which I describe as in between. The identitarian in-betweenness, which is characterized by this undecisiveness. On the one hand, there is some sort of, not maybe a protest is a very harsh word, but there is a disagreement with the one narrative over national identity, and there is clearly disagreement on the other. So the people are left in this between these two predominant discourses over national identity, this Russkii Mir discourse, which some might say this is not a very rural thing, but I was fascinated how much of the rural thing that was, and on the other hand, this pro-autocephaly discourse of the ruling elites. With regards to robustness of identity, I do not generalize with my limited samples, and I would was my general impression, a guess, that Ukraine has this very robust identity and identities, and definitely these were not my research results saying that, because I cannot claim the generalizability with the 77 interviews.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Oh, if I can make one comment in terms of identity and confession, we are talking really about switching jurisdictions or defining yourself within a particular jurisdiction. So again, to switch from one confession to another, you need a different symbol of faith, and again, so it's not like people are confusing themselves being Protestants versus Orthodox. It's just within the Orthodox Church there are the question of jurisdiction, and the names are changing, and the boundaries are changing, and so on and so forth. So from that point of view, it seems to me it's very easy to define or redefine yourself in the middle of interview. So Lubomir, please.
On this point that you were making, I would like to add the factor of the Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church, which, at least in the theological or ecclesiological thinking of the hierarchy of the Greek Catholic Church, that church is also Orthodox, and it claims to be that's descended from the Kievan baptism, and it was in a peculiar situation during this period when the Kievan Patriarchate was not considered to be canonical by other Orthodox churches, in that the Greek Catholic Church was the only kind of recognized church that would speak to the Kievan Patriarchate. And that has developed into a kind of a modus vivendi, which I think is in effect right now, especially in terms of reactions to the West, turning to the West. I think it is partly because of this. But I was wondering whether there were, other evidences of a kind of a role that the Greek Catholic Church may have been playing in all these various negotiations, transfers. To me, an interesting example, it's one example only, but that is in the Ukrainian autocephalous Orthodox Church until this union, until the Thomas, it itself was divided. The Western was more kind of, Western part of the country was more pro-Orthodox, but the Eastern in Kharkiv, autocephalous Orthodox Church, was drawing closer to the Greek Catholic Church. And in fact, Archbishop Isichenko, about whom we've had many occasions to speak with Professor Plohy, has apparently been pushing to have his church unite with the Greek Catholic Church. So I wonder whether this at all played a role in the kind of conversations you had with your interviewers.
Thank you very much. I because of the limited time and incredible pace of events that were part of this process, that the things developed every day, there was something new happening with regards to autocephaly. I didn't focus on the Greek Catholic Church for purely organizational reasons, because I was basically focusing on the Russian and Kievan churches, because there are two major Orthodox churches. Greek Catholic Church recognizes the supremacy of papal supremacy and has a Greek rite, and in some form it was not the target audience of my for very operational reasons. It was not for practical reasons. It was very difficult to actually go through that. But very good question about the role. It is difficult to know exactly the exact role, what was that, but one can say that the outreach for the autocephaly to the migrant, to the Ukrainian immigrant population through the Greek Catholic Church was present on online forums. There were opinion editorials written. There were a number of talks at UKU. So there was this intellectual part, intellectual discussion. I'm sure Vika can comment on that part more. I guess, but definitely from my research, I didn't have a chance to talk that much.
Okay, thank you, Dmitry, please.
Yeah, I had one comment and one question. There was an earlier conversation about the Russian government's role, right? And I just wanted to sort of note a possible reverse direction there, which is not that one of the reasons why the Russian Putin and the top leadership may be so interested is because they're being pushed by Kirill and the Russian Orthodox Church to put pressure on Ukraine to avoid losing the parishes, right? So it's not just a geopolitical argument from the political, from you know, sort of Russia versus Ukraine relations, but also an interest group kind of argument where the Russian Orthodox Church is trying to make sure that it remains an issue. My question was kind of more of an empirical question that I'm hoping maybe it's not directly relevant to your research, but I'm hoping you have some information on, which is what is the process of the transfer of assets? How is that working? Is there? It sounds from what you said that it's separate from these votes of the parishioners. Is there a law for this? Where does that stand?
Thank you. Yeah, I agree with you about the business part of things. The group argument is very powerful, and in one of the chapters I developed that, what I call belief actors thesis, which means that churches operate in particular based on particular organizational interests, and a huge interest, business interest, and commercial interests are in Ukraine of Russian Orthodox Church are massive, and that explains what you say, why Kirill is pushing Putin to bring a bit more harsh discourse on that. There are three main levers which are giving a lot of financial dividends to the Moscow Patriarchate in Kiev and Pochayev and in Eastern Ukraine. So these are properties of the Ukrainian state, but they're actually rented by the Moscow Patriarchate. So Moscow Patriarchate has steady income from that. There is a huge amount of immovable property that Moscow Patriarchate has. Actually, the amount of parishes at this point are 12,000 to 5,000 for Moscow Patriarchate. So twice more parishes of the Moscow Patriarchate are now, with its movable and immovable property, are registered on the territory of Ukraine as opposed to the Kiev Patriarchate. So then the question is, of course, what happens with the properties now when we have a new church? So some of the church properties that were Kiev Patriarchate or autocephalous, they became a part of this one united church, newly formed church. And what happens with assets, there are a number of court cases as we speak, how to divide those assets. For example, in the villages that I was, in some cases the court decided that the claim of the Kievan parish was illegitimate, so they used the church simultaneously. So on one part of the week, one parish is praying, the same like 3 days, one parish, then the other. But there were exceptional cases. Overwhelmingly, these transfers are also about property. They are about a big property, because the churches are very often empty, but there are a lot of icons and a lot of golden, very valuable assets. And who will own that defines a large status of the organization.
So it sounds like in most cases, if there's a vote to move from the Moscow Church to the Ukrainian Church, then in most cases the physical building and property also move.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's why it makes so much of. Organizational and group interest thing,
yes.
That it's about a huge amount of property. And not just the religious property, but also a lot of business activities, whether in wine business or whether in candle business, whether in icon business, you name it. There are huge varieties of businesses that churches are involved, and this automatically means that the next question, of course, will be who will have the monastery who produces wine, who owes this monastery now, and etc. There are a lot of technical questions like that. Yes.
Let me just jump in just on this point. Originally, and I think Tornike is exactly right, I think this court case is very important, because originally the way the government presented it, that there are basically kind of two types of ownership, but it's actually not true. So the original argument was that there are these lavras, right, that are owned by the state and the state leases them, and then the individual churches that belong to either Kiev Patriarchy or Moscow Patriarchy, right, and this number is like 12,000 over 5,000. But actually, a group of journalists did an analysis of property records for Odessa Oblast. I mean, and I'm imagining that, I don't know if you're familiar with this, and they found six different types of church ownership, six, including like individual people, like groups of people, local community, some sort of municipality, the church, right, like the Moscow Patriarchy or the Kiev Patriarchy, or undefined. So as you can imagine, that creates all sorts of problems, because the parish can vote to switch, but if there is like physically some group of four guys who own the church, like that's gonna go to court, right?
Yep.
So I think originally it was conceived to be as a much smoother process. Basically it was the idea that like if the parish votes, then the church would go with the parish, and then these lavras are going to be decided sort of, but it looks like it's much more complicated. And so I think these court cases are going to become very significant.
Yeah, at the time of my field work, there were a few hundred court cases,
mm-hmm.
in Western Ukraine only.
Mm-hmm.
So I cannot imagine what happened. I would really like to go to Ukraine as soon as I can. So in summertime, I'll go there. And there are like 450 something transitions already. And at the time there was 70, and there were already so many court issues. And then I met with activists who were working and a few lawyers who were involved in this case. And there are also fascinating discussions, what's the role of court? Because some of the court, highest members of the court, were involved in different business activities with people connected to the Russian Orthodox Church through different proxies. And then no wonder what was the decision on the court. And there were a lot of different nuances of this organizational interests that are out there and, open for research.
I just a question. With respect to Orthodox constituencies outside of Ukraine and Russia, whether they have patriarchs or not, in Southeastern Europe, in the rest of Europe, in North America, and Japan, how do they weigh in on this in terms of individual contacts, either through, you know, between patriarchs or between metropolitans with the corresponding officials in Ukraine and also, say, with the Moscow Patriarchy?
How do they weigh?
Weigh in.
How do they relate?
Okay.
How do they, you know.
Or how do they to other patriarchs?
How might they be involved?
With other patriarchies, that's what you're
talking about. Well, with the dramatis personae in Ukraine and in Russia.
Okay. How do they interact with them? How are they reacting to this problem?
The most current discussion is to get recognition from the other churches. So now the Ukrainian Orthodox Church has the recognition of the Patriarch of Constantinople. The Georgian Orthodox Church had a few visits from the Moscow Patriarchate and the Kiev Patriarchate at the time, and that abstained to recognize. So there are a lot of, now the Cyprus Orthodox Church made a comment, the Romanian Orthodox Church very recently, like a week ago, made a comment that they're considering a conversation about this. So if we're talking about the scale of this autocephaly, whether or not this can be manifesting in full-blown recognition by other members, because as I told you, there are 14 members which are recognized by all and two that are not recognized by all of them, but are by some. These are the Orthodox Church of the United States and Ukraine. These are recognized just by two, and the 14 recognize each other, other 14 autocephalous churches. The question is, and there the question is the generational gap between the leaderships of the churches. For example, Georgian church is ruled by Patriarch Ilya, who is there since 70s, late 70s, early 80s, and relatively newer churches that are having predominantly younger bishops. Already around the 12 Georgian bishops publicly stated support of Ukrainian autocephaly. So to gain this broad support, it will be very difficult to have through synodal discussions, but it might be that individual metropolitans of each canonical church will start to recognize the Ukrainian autocephaly, which will give de facto the legitimacy to the Thomas in the eyes of the entire Orthodox community. I apologize if I didn't answer your question, but that's how I can interpret it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I have two questions. One builds up on what's been discussed, and one is something else. I wonder when, because we saw the maps of churches transferring, and of course there were many more flags in the West and kind of gradually spreading to the East, and that can speak to the kind of political motivation to switch. But it could also speak to the sheer density of churches. Something that he just mentioned, that, you know, there was the highest density of churches compared to Russia, but of course within Ukraine they're also not evenly distributed. And that might also speak to the question the girl asked, you just left, on religiousness and how religious you are. And I'm now thinking back, one of the data you showed us was on, you know, West, Center, East, whatever, you had like three or four groups, and whether you identified with what kind of Orthodox, and the group simply Orthodox, it was almost 50% going East, and, you know, only like 5% going West. So I wonder, probably not for your research as such, but for the context and how you set it in your context chapters, that could be relevant, you know, whether there is any correlation. Because when we see just, we see a map, we say, aha, the West is massively changing.
Yeah.
But maybe it's because they have five times as many churches and they're actually religious and they actually identify with specific confession compared to the East, where they are maybe, you know, just simply Orthodox and there are like fewer churches and it's less of an issue. So I wonder if that's, you know, in any way relevant to your research and if you want to pick it up in your analysis.
Thank you. The density of churches is actually of the Orthodox churches is quite even. Eastern Orthodox churches are in the eastern and central Ukraine, the physical buildings, if we're talking about that.
Yeah.
In fact, the amount of parishes, as I told you, is twice more in entire Ukraine. So distribution is not, of the Orthodox churches, distribution in the western Ukraine is not somewhat different from the overall distribution of the Orthodox churches across Ukraine of the Moscow Patriarchate. So I don't think the territoriality in this case is something to take into the consideration.
I think it would be just interesting then to dismiss it up front, like, by the way, this is not a fact, that there is no correlation with this, there is no correlation with that.
Yeah, I don't even argue about correlation. I'm very careful with words what I'm using. I'm not arguing about correlations. I'm trying to explain and name the particular phenomenon. That's what my particular purpose of this project is. So I'm not claiming generalizability, and I'm not claiming the correlationship, and I'm not generalizing on the entire population of Ukraine. But the Razumkov Center does a great job about that, and there is MAPA project which will, I'm sure,
Okay. And we have the data and we have the maps with the number of the parishes and how it was changing since 1991. And again, per capita, Victoria, if I am not mistaken, the center and west is really, we have much, much larger representation of the churches than the east. But this is per capita in terms of the absolute numbers, probably.
Yep.
That's what, it is different. Okay.
Second question.
Sure.
I don't know if it's part of this research or maybe you're thinking about this in the future, but when I'm thinking back to when this autocephaly was discussed and when the Tomos was handed, there were all these memes around the internet, you know, this is a unique day, Ukrainian Orthodox Christian, you know, Catholics, Greek Catholics, Jews, Buddhists, Protestants, you know, atheists and agnostics are all celebrating the autocephaly. So, you know, when you speak of motivations for church, I wonder if you look at any way this parish versus community, you know, how cities are happy if the church changes hands, even if they don't go to this specific church. And I wonder if these people in any way factor into this project or maybe your next project.
Well, very interesting. Part of the reason why I'm going back is to see this kind of general atmosphere, and definitely see how this motive narratives, which I call motive narratives, change and to what extent they reflect the mood. So far, I was observing the online happiness. This was not necessarily the most accurate representative or accurate description of things. And of course, if you follow their individual commentators and bloggers who were lobbying for this for many on both sides, and there was a lot of happiness. And but again, I cannot. I maybe for the next project, but definitely now I don't have this idea how it was received across other communities on the ground, because I was not actually physically in Ukraine.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Yes, gentlemen over there.
Thanks a lot for your presentation, first of all. I'm not an expert in regional issues. I would like to ask a question rather on geopolitical and political issues. And the question would be, on the one hand, it was a kind of necessary step decision to decrease the dependency of Ukrainian church and Ukrainian government on Russia, and to split them. Ukrainian church and from the Russian church. And from another side, I mean, to my opinion, it would be interesting to have your opinion too, but I'm saying my opinion, there's another step to split in terms of fragmentation, in terms of to divide country, and another aspect, I mean,
what do you exactly mean by divide the country?
Divide a country in Ukraine, I think everything is sort of politicized and polarized, like cities, languages, and now churches too. You know, just it's another aspect to divide people into two groups. You belong to this church, I belong to this church.
Mm-hmm.
And you try to stay to keep your neutrality, but I would like to have some precise answer on my question. Would you say it was a right and necessary decision to split the churches or not? In my first question, the second one, I would like to ask a question on your theories that you use in your project. You mentioned it, you know, just geopolitics, international relations, but in the interpretations of just whom, just Kenneth Boss or Mesheimer, because as I know, international relations, it hasn't been studied pretty well, I mean, as I know it, so religional aspect of this issue. And that's why I would like to have your opinion, to ask for your opinion. Did you find enough books, materials, resources on this topic to help to progress your project?
Mm-hmm.
That's my second question.
Thank you very much. The first question, I will try to be as precise as I can, whether the split was right or wrong, obviously Ukrainian people had expressed their will to have their own church through, and this is seen through a number of polls, and on my personal opinion, I don't think any problem with when overwhelming majority wanted to have its own church, why should they not have the church? This is how Russian Church got Thomas, how Georgian Church got Thomas, and overwhelmingly, this is how autocephaly was given to every Orthodox Church in the world, through the will, manifestation of the will of free will of people. Regards to the second question, I'm a sociologist, so I'm not having this theoretical discussion with the IR theories, so I'm not in the conversation with them. I'm more conversation with the sociology of religion literature, and here. There are varieties of very interesting works. Some of them I mentioned here. Many of them I didn't mention. That deal with the issue of church-state relations. And there are a lot of secularization theory discussions, which some of them are applied to the Eastern Orthodox contexts. Some of them not. There are multiple secularism theories. There are multiple modernities. I mean, there are political science discussions on this topic. So the literature is thick enough, to help us to move forward with our categories.
Thanks. By the way, in terms of the splitting, before the Thomas, there were three Orthodox churches in Ukraine. Today there are two. So, the actually, it's a particular prism and again split is something that is already in the word itself, in the concept itself, you see a particular view from Moscow. In reality, in terms of number of registered churches, there are less now Orthodox churches in Ukraine as separate jurisdictions than there were before.
I apologize, may I just quickly add to this comment? So the Ukrainian Kiev Patriarchate has a long tradition in the rituals as well as theological thought. So it was not created ex nihilo. This church existed there for a few decades. It has a tradition of Christianity. So it is not like ex nihilo creation, as some of the media commentators portrayed in some of the sources that I read. So that was a very expected move in some form. So there are a lot of churches in Orthodox Christianity who are autonomous churches, meaning that they do not have the right to elect their patriarch. The bishops have particular legitimization issues in the entire world Orthodox communities. But Ukrainian Orthodox Church has a full-blown Orthodox system with its rituals, with its church singing, with its way of prayer, with its theology, and so the organizational structure was there. And part of that was the reason why the Patriarch of Constantinople considered that readiness, one of the criteria of becoming the autocephalous, is the infrastructure and this intellectual side. And so this all ticks were there for many, many years. It was not a construct by Poroshenko who wanted to win elections, as some commentators portray. This tradition should be separated for political discussions, because of course the political elite wanted to capitalize on this, but this tradition was there. It was not invented, as Hobsbawm would have said. It was not an invented tradition out of all.
Okay, thank you. Natalia, please. Yeah.
Do you please go to the previous slide? Right. So you have here a category, Prosto-Pravoslavny. From what I understand, this is someone who believes but does not go to church. But then from also, as far as I understand, you wrote by years.
I didn't. It's Razumkov's data. It's Razumkov's data. I didn't break.
Oh, okay. Because my question was that babushka, who didn't want to pick up church just to avoid any several kind of uncomfortable situation. I mean, where would she be here? Like, in Prosto Pravoslavne, I take it, but I guess.
Well, as I argue that this is not a very bold argument, but because of the sampling strategies so far, but I think this in-betweenness is the category that can be fitting. Probably this is a separate category. This is not Prosto Pravoslavny, because if we're talking about this identitarian in-betweenness, this is between those categories of Orthodox. So it's maybe a distinct category, distinct practice of
so that would be another one.
Well, I'm not sure how it can be generalized again on the broader sample. We mm-hmm. cannot say that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. But
I just was wondering, did you have any chance, or do you have any information about the what's involved with the Donbass areas of Lugansk? Is there any option in this area for implementation of the change, or what is happening? How is this affecting the division, that division of Ukraine?
I see. I didn't have access to this because of many security reasons. I'm actually at this point, I'm trying my best to organize field work there in next year. I'm in negotiation with a few local NGOs who are from Kiev but who have network in these parts, and also in Crimea, because it's a fascinating thing that's going on now in Crimea with regards to this revitalization of this Russian Orthodox Church. Even the post offices, many public organizations have already a significant presence of the Russian Orthodox Church in Crimea, and it's very interesting to see that. But I have a really wrong citizenship, Georgian citizenship, which is not necessarily the friendliest passport that you can have to enter Crimea these days. But I'm working on going there and definitely seeing these three, particularly how this these regions are operating, particularly in this regards to the church-state relationships. But this is an ongoing discussion, so I do not have any data on that now.
Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
Hi, so I just had a quick question about whether or not you could summarize. You mentioned the preeminence of the Russian model in interpreting state-church relationships across the former Soviet Union, and could you just quickly summarize the differences you perceive in church-state, church-nation, state-nation dynamics in Ukraine, Georgia, and Russia, for example?
This is what I'm pretty much done with the first book project, which compared Georgia, Serbia, and Ukraine with regards to how churches influence policies and what's their organizational interests. Ukraine is unique from all, mainly for the reason that, at least until today, that the influence of church on the state was very, very minimal. In Georgia and Serbia, this influence manifested itself as you know,
on the state or state on the church?
Of church on the state.
Okay.
And this is a Russian, very close to, very much close to, I think what Ukraine is very unique in the case that there was no direct influence of religion on decisions of the state. In Georgian case, we had a number of laws that were basically vetoed by the church. There were huge public mobilizations against the LGBT communities, particular movies, particular intellectuals. But of course the scale is very different of Georgia and Ukraine, and probably it will be difficult for the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, even if they want to operate the way the Georgian Church does. But what I argue in the book is that when organizational interests of these religious actors are met, they tend to be acting more social. So their behavior becomes more on the social issues like alcoholism, drugs, gambling. But when their interests, and in Georgia's case and Serbia's case, I'm arguing the material, economical interests, business interests, are met by the political elites, then there is pretty much no conflict of interest. However, when they are challenged, then becomes the problem of LGBT, of feminism, of Western influence, of globalization. And the churches in these countries have these two cards, two discourses. On the one hand, this political, militarist discourse, and very aggressive attitude towards minorities, which was not the case in Ukraine so far. Again, we're talking about the scale, but compared to the Georgian scale and Serbian scale, this was very different. And the other thing is the law, legal system. As has been mentioned, Ukraine by default had a very different legal situation. Georgian church has a superiority over all religions, and this is coded by the constitutional agreement between the state and the church. So basically, Georgian Orthodox Church can have business activities and has business activities without a state having right to intervene it's a state within the state. And this model is something not seen so far in Ukraine, because Ukrainian model, I think, is closest to the American model of free market competition, the closest, and this is not my argument, these are some of the major sociologists that have studied this, market theories, bringing Ukraine as a case study. And I think if this is under question, it'd be very pity to miss this opportunity, because Ukraine has this unique field, a very good legal system, and a very vibrant religious competition. And if Ukraine goes to the Russian model, where the church state will be in symphony, one appointing the other, from time to time, one legalizing the existence of the other, of course, it will be very disappointing. But I don't see any reason why shall it be so far, because there are a lot of competition on the ground.
If I could add to that, in terms of the Russian model, I mentioned there were a number of attempts to turn one of the branches of the Orthodox Church into de facto a state church, but the pluralism overall was a problem, but also the fact that you have two traditional churches that claim to be national churches at the same time. It's the branch of the Orthodox Church and the Greek Catholic Church. And if you have two churches with the same kind of claim, you're in a really very difficult position to create one church which are confessionally actually different. So the differences going on back and goes back to the 16th century. So just by the if you even forget about all the splits and all other Christian groups and non-Christian groups in Ukraine, the fact that you have traditionally two national churches makes the Russian model actually unrealistic. I guess we still have time for maybe one last parting question.
Can I just ask one more question on this regional business, right? You said earlier, if I understood correctly, that in the West there is more kind of religiosity and more per capita kind of churches, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the maps mm-hmm. show that, right? Mm-hmm. People are more religious generally, and there are more, you know, churches and so forth. And in Ukraine, it's also, I mean, Western Ukraine is also the part of the country where sort of talking about geopolitical influences or attitudes, right? It would be kind of the most friendly, we can say, for this project of independent church, right? And that's where we sort of not surprisingly see a lot of changes, right? But at the same time, I mean, there was a lot of Russian Moscow Patriarchy churches there, right? And some of them are not switching. Do you get a sense from your respondents, like, what is preventing them, right? Because, I mean, in the East, we can say, like, the fact that, you know, these ideas of Russkii Mir are more prevalent and so forth, right? Like, I mean, that would presumably be less of an issue in the West. I mean, I would imagine earlier this question about the canonicity was very important, because if you are a believer and you believe your church, like, you wouldn't receive grace, right, by going to the non-canonical church. Like, mm-hmm. I could see how that would hold people who, mm-hmm. you know, but now, like, that obstacle seemed to have been removed, right? Or maybe, I mean, but I'm not sure if the faithful of the Moscow Patriarchy Church in Western regions, like, what are kind of, I mean, I know you're not generalizing broadly, but just from the interviews that you did, like, if you said
excellent question, and I would argue that Russkii Mir is actually the major argument why what's happening here. The Pochayiv Lavra is the territory. This is here, around here, and all the most switches have been here. And this is the backbone of the idea of Russkii Mir. Pochayiv Lavra is full of the extremely conservative monks and very conservative clerics. And the reason why people do not switch very often in the Western part is actually their admiration of the way of life and particular canonical rationale of some behaviors, based on this idea of Russkii Mir. So it's actually Western Ukrainian non-switching pattern in the sample that, again, I have, was this loyalty towards a canonical, non-canonical thing. And second, this idea that I belong to something bigger than this is, these borders are, that this territory is. My identity is more than just one. And another is that religion plays a very fundamental role here. And in this part, the most conservative priests from the Russian Orthodox Church are sent to the Western Ukraine. In fact, the more dogmatic, very, very, very similar to the Russian Orthodox Church in their visual, in Eastern and Central parts of Ukraine, you can see the priest, for example, when it's, let's say, off working hours, he can wear regular clothes. But the dress codes even are very strict around Pochayiv's territory for the members of the Moscow Patriarchate. So the visual, even the visual presence of this dogmatic element is strong. And in the interviews in the Western Ukraine, again, I had interviews mostly with people who switched, but I had failed many interviews, but I had a few successful cases in these parts. And this idea of думать по-русски, thinking in Russian, loving something bigger than this is, and some of them were dividing. In one particular interview, it was very interesting. That was a vision of division of Ukraine in the idea of Russkii Mir. How this Russkii Mir can be mapped in Western Ukraine, and it was totally novel and interesting vision in one of the villages by one of the priests that has this idea how Western Ukraine can be more Russian in a cultural sense, where borders will not matter and where will be the center and etc. So there were a lot of these motive narratives were driven by the Russkii Mir idea rather than not. So it's not just an Eastern Ukrainian central thing. It's actually relatively liberal and less conservative, let's say, less conservative priests from the Moscow Church were in the Dnipro, in Poltava, Cherkasy regions, in Kharkiv. Much more conservative priests, absolutely, in Chernivtsi, Ivano-Frankivsk, Thermopyl, without a doubt in Rivne. So this was from the Moscow Patriarchate. again. There was impossible to actually have an appointment with some of them unless you had an agreement with the bishop, in many cases, where the access to other, on the Kiev Patriarchate was much easier, by the same, we followed the same procedure. One was extremely complicated, and the other was very, this of course also tells us a lot about the policy of outreach, but we saw a significant problems of accessing this priest. The system was very centralized. Again, if we look at the Ukrainian Kievan Church, Kiev Patriarchate, decision on whether to talk to me or not was made by the priest in the village. Whereas if we compare it to the Moscow Patriarchates, it was called to the press office in somewhere, sometimes in Kiev or a regional center, and then this was decided whether this person that was literally in front of me could have answered my questions or not. So this replicated very much the Russian Orthodox Church's hierarchical system, same in Georgia, same in Serbia, but not very much same in Kiev Patriarchate. So I don't know, interesting will be, what will be the organizational setup of the newly formed Orthodox Church of Ukraine, because there are some bishops that were from Moscow Patriarchate and who joined the newly formed church. They of course come with their own vision of what it means to be a priest and what it means to be a bishop. And it will be interesting how these internal conflicts will be accommodated and how sustainable this church will be as an organization. But we don't have evidence now because it's a really new thing, and it's definitely an interesting subject to look at.
Thank you very much. Well, I hope there will be an opportunity for you to come back and present the results of your summer research in Ukraine, and we'll learn from your presentation what is actually going on and what is happening with this new wave of transitions. So thank you.
Thank you.
Once again for very interesting presentation. Thank you for your questions.